So, welcome to the third lecture of sixth week. So, till now we saw that you could start with a couple system, like for instance a collection of particles which were tied together by strings, and the particles were positioned at equal distances from one another. And by taking the limit that these particles come closer and closer, or we said that the distance between them A tends to 0, and in that limit we derived an operational equation which is called the wave equation. And we also rederived the same equation by considering a small segment of an oscillating string. So, there is some string which is oscillating for whatever reason, and you consider a small segment of the string, look at the kind of forces acting on that small segment of the string, and from that we are able to derive an equation of motion which is called the wave equation. An important input there is that we are still considering small amplitude oscillations. So, we will continue to look at small amplitude oscillations. Then we went ahead and looked at the solutions of this wave equations. So, we saw that physically it corresponds to a wave that is traveling in either say positive x direction or negative x direction. So, these are the two possible kinds of solutions that wave equation would ultimately lead to in one dimension. So, these are called progressive waves because they simply keep propagating in one direction. On the other hand, there is another class that you can sort of manufacture by using these progressive waves. Suppose, let us say you put in a boundary at the end, so that the wave that you produced cannot escape off to infinity, but will have to be reflected off from some let us say a rigid wall. You can easily do this by, let us say, tying a string between two walls and create a small disturbance somewhere in between. The disturbance would travel, let us say, in one direction or even both the direction. It will go and hit the wall. Clearly, a small disturbance like this cannot penetrate the heavy walls. So, it would be reflected, and soon you would see what would typically be called standing waves. They are called standing simply because on the face of it, visually when you look at it, it would appear as though the waves are not really moving. So, physically what you need to create standing waves are these two boundaries at two ends in one dimension, so that the reflected component and the incoming component of the wave can together finally lead to a standing wave pattern. In today's lecture, we will look at the standing wave pattern, or what it means to say that a wave is standing. So, the solution that I have written actually consists of two parts. There is this part which corresponds to a plane wave that is traveling in the positive x direction, okay, let us say in this direction, positive x direction. And the second part is this, where it is a plane wave again, but traveling in the negative x direction, in this direction. So, you do not know in which direction your wave might be traveling if you make an arbitrary disturbance. So, in general you assume that your waveform is something that travels in both the directions. A and B are two amplitudes. They would continue to remain unspecified. So, this comes out as the solution of your wave equation, and we superposed two possible solutions. Now, the next point is to put in the boundary conditions. We said that to create a standing wave, you need to have maybe two walls between which you might possibly tie your string and create a disturbance. In other words, one way of expressing this idea is to say that of course, string is your medium in which the wave is going to travel, and at this point, let us call this x axis, at x equal to 0 and x equal to L, there is a change of medium. So, what was string is now suddenly becoming a hard wall. So, that is the case at x equal to L and x equal to 0. So, which means if you tied your string at these two positions, then the usual boundary conditions would apply, which would be a statement that at x equal to 0, your y, which is the displacement, would be 0. And similarly, at x equal to L, displacement is 0. So, we have a general solution here, which is given by this equation. And now, we want to obtain a solution which respects these two boundary conditions. So, if we get that, we would have solved the problem. So, the next step obviously is to plug in these boundary conditions into the general solution that we have. So, let us start with the first boundary condition, which is that at x equal to 0, y is equal to 0. So, now I am going to apply this boundary condition. So, if I say that at x equal to 0, y equal to 0, I would get the following. So, 0 is equal to a into e power I omega t plus b into e power I omega t, which can be written as a plus b into e power I omega t. And for this to be equal to 0, it is a plus b which has to go to 0, because e power I omega t is not identically equal to 0 for all arbitrary values of omega and t, which means that this equation implies that a plus b is equal to 0, which implies that a is equal to minus b. So, the two amplitudes, the amplitude of the left going wave and the amplitude of the right going wave, are equal in magnitude but opposite in signs. It should not be too surprising, because all it tells us is that if you have a wave which is going towards the right and there is a hard boundary at the right end, which means that you have something like a wall there and it is going to get reflected, there is a phase change of pi upon reflection. So, this essentially is a reflection of that fact, which means that now we can incorporate this this condition into our solution. This can be rewritten. Of course, I should put a here. This can be simplified in the following way: a into e power I omega t into e power minus I k x minus e power I k x. Now, the next step is somewhat obvious. You can divide it by 2i and multiply by 2i, and if you do that, this quantity can be written as minus 2i a into e power I omega t into sin k x. So, this is my solution that respects the boundary condition that at x equal to 0, y is equal to 0. And that clearly comes out here, because if I put x equal to 0 in this equation, y is indeed equal to 0, because sin k x will be equal to 0 in that case. Okay. Now, we had one more boundary condition as well, namely that at x equal to L, y is equal to 0 as well. Now, of course, amplitude a is not equal to 0 in general, and e power I omega t is not equal to 0 in general, and 2i is a constant. So, the only way in which this could generate a 0 is if sin k l is equal to 0. And if sin k l is equal to 0, this is going to give me the following condition, because this would imply that k l should be equal to n pi. And since omega now depends on n, remember that omega is the angular frequency, more correctly the normal mode frequency for our string. So, it depends on this integer n. To indicate that, let me say that omega is, put a subscript omega n, and omega n into L divided by C would be equal to n pi, and this gives me an expression for omega n, which will be n pi C divided by L. So, these are the normal mode frequencies for this problem. So, one thing is very clear that arbitrary values of normal mode frequencies are not possible. So, you have some basic quantity that is given by pi C by L, and integer multiples of that are the possible normal mode frequency for this standing waves. Since I have expression for omega n, which is n pi C by L, where C is the phase velocity of the wave, I can also write it in terms of the frequency, not the angular frequency, just the frequency. So, that would be nu n, which is the frequency, would be equal to n pi C by 2 pi L, that would be n C by 2 L. And using this, I can also write an expression for wavelength, because we know that nu, which is frequency multiplied by the wavelength, is equal to C, the velocity of the wave, phase velocity. Wavelength will simply be equal to C by nu. So, I can extract that parameter here. So, C by nu n would be equal to 2 L by n, and that is equal to lambda n. So, this quantity is again very important and useful for our purpose. So, we know the angular frequency, we know the frequency, and we also know what the wavelength is. It is related to just the length of the total length of the string tied between, let us say, two rigid walls. Let us now visualize the pattern of oscillations, given that we have assembled all these results together. To do that, let me draw for you this picture of two walls, and this is x equal to 0 and this is x equal to L. Omega n is n pi C by L, and lambda n is 2 L by n. And since n is equal to 1, I can erase this n here. So, lambda n is equal to 2 L, and 2 L is twice the length of our total string length that we are considering. So, which means that between 0 and L, it should correspond to half the wavelength. In other words, length L is simply equal to half the wavelength when you are looking at the fundamental mode. So, then that is a clue to draw the picture that would correspond to an oscillation of this type. So, this is one possible pattern for the fundamental mode or n equal to 1 mode. In principle, you could have another possibility, which is a mirror image of this. Now, let us go to the next mode, first excited mode or next highest frequency. So, in this case I should write it as omega 2, maybe I should have written this as omega 1, let me do that. This is omega 1 and this is of course lambda 1. Now, omega 2 will be equal to 2 pi c by L and lambda 2 will be equal to L itself. So, the entire length of the string that lies between the two walls is equal to one wavelength in this mode. So, I should be able to visualize it as, let us say this is the midpoint. Similarly, I can do for n equal to 3 as well. Here omega 3 will be equal to 3 pi c by L and lambda 3 will be equal to 2L by 3. So, if lambda 3 is equal to 2L by 3, it is equivalent to saying that the entire length between the two walls would be occupied by 3 by 2 times the wavelength or 1.5 times the wavelength. So, that gives us the clue as to how to plot this. So, let us divide it into 3 parts roughly. So, you see that there is no 0 crossing in this. On the other hand, you see that there is one 0 crossing here, which is this point. And here there are 2 0 crossings in the case of n equal to 3. So, these points where there are 0 crossings, they are called the nodes, node or nodes. And these points where the amplitude is maximum, like this ones. So, these would be called the antinodes. So, you can see that there is a progression, there is a very clear relationship between n and the number of nodes in your in a particular mode. And you will also notice that for whatever I have drawn n equal to 1, 2 and 3 cases, in all the cases at x equal to 0 and at x equal to L, y is equal to 0, which is the boundary condition that we demanded, and the solutions that we are getting precisely respect those boundary conditions. Now, we can write the final solution. So, I have written down what we had obtained earlier, that y of x t is equal to minus 2 I times the amplitude A into e power I omega t into sin k x. Now, let us write this in a more explicit form. So, now my solution would tell me that I am writing down the solution for the nth normal mode. So, y n of x comma t. So, n here is an integer that would index the normal mode. So, in this A is the amplitude, which can only be determined from the initial condition, omega n is the normal mode frequency. This provides the complete solution for the standing wave problem. So, if you are careful about it, you would notice that the amplitude has a I and seems to convey that there is some imaginary part to it, but that can be absorbed as a phase in the e power I omega t term. So, it is not really a problem. So, all these would be settled if you actually look at a specific case of a standing wave where you would put in some initial conditions. And I would like to leave you with this picture of progression of the patterns that standing waves create as you change the mode number.